I knew you were connected, but to have learned of recent events and be here already? I don't impress easy, but well done.
The data brought to us by the Bothan spies pinpoints the exact location of the Emperor's new battle station. Many Bothans died to bring us this information.
What's up, Meta Nerds? This video will be a complete breakdown of the Bothan species, looking into their biology, homeworld, and history, and ending on some behind-the-scenes facts. But first, I want to thank this video's sponsor, Private Internet Access. PIA is the world's most transparent VPN provider, with a no-log policy that has a proven track record, beating multiple court cases where governments tried to collect data on individuals. VPNs work by changing your IP address, rerouting, and mixing your activity through shared encrypted servers across 75 different countries, making it impossible to say if it was your computer doing a search, while also allowing you to make it appear like you were in another country. Then they went and made this really user-friendly, with a phone and computer app that allows you to change your location around the world in just a matter of seconds. And you can look up things like a list of regional exclusives on Netflix to see where you need to switch to in order to get the most out of the memberships that you already pay for. And PIA is one of the few to work with peer-to-peer file sharing and torrenting, while also acting as an ad blocker and antivirus. This works on Windows, Mac, Android, Linux, and iOS, and with one account you can protect up to 10 devices all at the same time, while accepting payment in the form of credit and debit cards, PayPal or gift cards, and even cryptocurrency. Protect yourself online while also getting the most out of your streaming services, all for just $2.08 a month for a 3-year subscription plus 2 extra months free. That's 83% off by using our link down in the description. Plus, everything is risk-free. You're protected by a 30-day money-back guarantee, and the customer support team is available 24/7. So be sure to check out that link down below. But let's head to grid coordinates R14, the mid-rim of the galaxy, to the planet Bothuai. This was a very Earth-like world, with Type 1 atmosphere, which was breathable to most species, and covered in diverse landscapes from plains, forests, mountains, and large oceans with a pair of ice caps at the poles. Unlike other humanoid species like the Zabrak or Twi'lek, there is no evidence that the Bothans were artificially created, except for the larger mystery over the vast number of humanoid species that hints to a shared creation or ancestor in the form of the Celestials. A race far more ancient than even the Rakata, and who shaped the galaxy as we know it with their ability to move stars and planets. But some evidence that does point to an artificial creation is that Bothans can interbreed with humans, seen most notably with Jedi Lord Valentine Farfalla. And so though not confirmed, the other species that we know can interbreed with humans were artificially created from the Rakata. But since the best universities on Coruscant have yet to confirm an alien involvement in Bothan evolution, we will assume that they naturally evolved on Bothuai. A lush and dangerous world with skies filled with various birds of prey, and even reptilian creatures dubbed the Bothan Sky Dragons, the Rawls or stone rays that could camouflage while sunning on rocks, packing a venomous stinger tail, razor-sharp beaks, and hard needle teeth, while on land there were stampeding herds of Ganjuku, which had thick hair over their tough skin and teeth that were so large and sharp that they were prized across the galaxy to be made into daggers, all used to fight off the Krekjaya, a deadly feline predator, and the Skarkla, a bipedal crocodile rancor-like beast, while even plants could kill you with things like the Halkra, or so-called strangle vines, whose subspecies could be found on every continent, adapting to be almost indistinguishable from countless other harmless vines. The Halkra's 12 tentacle-like vines would spread out over several meters, springing into action upon contact to pull the prey into the plant's digestive sac. And though the seas were surprisingly peaceful, even the soil possessed threats to Bothan evolutionary success, with scalworms and radarks that lurked right under their feet. All of this gives us the context for the rise of this small furry species, as this environment pressured each living thing to develop great defensive measures, or deadly weapons, or in the case of the Bothans, a brilliant mind. Much like humans, they were one of the easiest prey to kill, and lacked the claws and power of the predators. But over eons, each generation was growing smarter and smarter. Even the modern Bothan only stood 1.5 meters, or just under 5 feet tall, putting them in between an Ewok and a Wookiee. It's unknown how short their lifespan was during the formation of their civilization, and that long road to becoming the dominant species on Bothuai, but by the time they became a spacefaring race, their average lifespan was 85 years, a bit longer than most other humanoids. And they did develop their own spacefaring technology independently from any other species, eventually coming into contact with intelligent alien life, becoming one of the earliest members of the Galactic Republic, even having a chancellor around 11,987 BBY. Over the centuries, most species became well aware that the stereotypical Bothan was incredibly intelligent, cunning, and ambitious. The result of an entire culture that, even in this spacefaring age, never forgot the mindset that liberated them from the deadly beasts of their homeworld. They kept the same basic social structure for millennia, having families that were organized into clans, with a Bothan name having three separate names, the given name, family name, and clan name. One of the most notable clans was Stone Clan, which produced the cultural hero Gom Firsjaw, who would have been the equivalent of a prophet to more religious species, writing a collection of wisdom called The Way. One of the lines states, quote, "By your own hands you may prevent your own defeat, but the opportunity to defeat your rival is provided by the rival himself." It taught the ultimate self-control, ever vigilant to ways to advance oneself, then expanding this philosophy out to say that each Bothan should put their interest above all others, then their family above all other families, and clan before all other clans. There was not a plurality of religions or competing philosophical beliefs in the Bothan zeitgeist. Instead, just about every one of them lived by the Way, for countless generations, even into the age of the Old Republic. But the Way absolutely forbid violence. The Bothan Council, which had 18 members from each of the nation-states that arose out of the regional clan alliances, and then eventually their colonies, would act as the operating government for all of Bothan space, and enforce the strict policies concerning individual weapon ownership, and in line with the Way, they never created a space naval force, instead investing in the best planetary shields money could buy, though there was a small defense force for the Council. So while they put their species above all others, as they expanded, they quickly saw that all of those other species were willing to use warships, blasters, and proton torpedoes to gain their power. Bothans realized that after all of this great technological progress, they had returned to the same landscape of their forefathers. Now a cosmic jungle, all hoping to devour the diminutive, weaponless Bothans. Again, they would rely on their intellect. As the galaxy was seeing an explosion of growth as more and more cultures were incorporated into the Republic, this era saw the development of complex networks of hyperspace lanes, which were then used to wage galactic-scale wars. Manufacturers like Huat Drive Yards and Rendili Star Drives would pump out warships, while the Bothans became synonymous with intel. The Bothan spy net was not a single entity, but a term for the loosely associated Bothan clans that engaged in every form of surveillance, espionage, and theft to gain intel that could be sold off to pirates, bounty hunters, militias, planetary governments, and eventually even the Republic and Sith Empire. They had no alliances, selling to both sides of every conflict, as Bothan data-gathering techniques were almost never directly uncovered. No one could point to exactly how they got the intel, but everyone knew that if they made enemies of these furry slicers, their deepest and darkest secrets would be exposed. And thus, without a powerful military presence, the Bothan-held worlds would remain unscathed by the wars that set most star systems ablaze. Even places like Rendili and Kuat would see invasions, but not Bothuai. All thanks to the spy net and that powerful shield. Everyone knew that anyone who initiated an invasion would trigger the spy net to carry out a complete data purge and hacking campaign. The invaders' information would be released to all of their enemies, giving up everything from the homes of politicians' family members to technical data on starships or landing codes for bases. The Bothans made sure the galaxy knew that any attack on them would result in mutual destruction. The invaders' territories would be plunged into chaos, ripped apart by the information that the Bothans provided to the enemy of their enemy. And because of this, Bothuai had only been attacked once by the 23rd Pious Dea Crusade back before those massive shields were in place, and then after the shield's creation, the only force crazy enough to attempt an invasion would be the Sith Empire, and at the time that most would consider to be at their peak of Imperial power. An empire that was also incredibly well hidden and not involved in most of the galaxy at large, during the Great Galactic War from 3681 BBY to 3653 BBY. One of the most intense moments was during the Battle of Bothuai, where their homeworld was assaulted multiple times, with the Republic blockade fleet holding off the first wave, then the shield preventing a major invasion, and then a third wave had a strike team deliver over 50,000 troops, dropped to the surface via an armada of smaller craft, intent on destroying the shield generator from the surface. A single Jedi Master named Balthalusus, his 84 knights, and only 4,000 Republic troops were able to hold the Sith forces off, killing 40,000 of them before finally being overwhelmed. Though when the smoke cleared, the invaders realized that in this fighting, their means of destroying the shield generator had also been lost, and Moff Zelus's devastating losses on this world are believed to have cost him his life. as the Moth was never heard from again, last seen making his report on the Battle of Bothawai to the Emperor. As you can see, the Republic was unwilling to lose this world, and as the war died down over the millennia, Bothawai became an ever-increasing economic center, being located in the Slice, the junction of four major hyperlanes. This made it a great center for megacorporations and communications arrays, both excellent vectors for the growing power of the Bothan spy network. The matter-of-factness that the Bothans had towards espionage spread through the corporate culture, and spying became just another cost of doing business. The Bothan Council promoted this behavior and kept low taxes and minimal regulations to entice businesses to the more free, open, and safer Midrim rival of Coruscant. As more and more species became accustomed to seeing Bothans in the boardroom, keen students of these people knew to keep an eye on their fur when negotiating, because the Bothans had a trait called Rendui, where their fur would have these gentle ripplings that were a response to their emotions. For thousands of years, the volatile forces known as the Sith seemed to have disappeared from the galaxy, and Bothans kept ensuring that they were the undisputed kings of Intel. Long before the official start of the Clone Wars with the Battle of Geonosis in 22 BBY, Bothan Senator Polo Salab had been abstaining from votes that he felt were polarizing the galaxy, sensing that war was brewing, and vowing to remain neutral through the conflict, making them one of the few worlds to have been with the Republic for so long that did not either fiercely defend or oppose the 25,000-year-old galactic government. Their council established a Bothan Martial Academy, though these forces were often mocked for how weak and thoroughly unfrightening they were with a blaster. Though, as you might expect, their slicing skills were greater than any force out there. The council directed the various clans of the Spynet on what intel should be released and to whom, in their attempt to guide this conflict towards a quicker end, being the only real great annoyance to the puppet master Palpatine throughout the length of the war. Though openly, he would often call on Count Dooku to meet for peace talks on Bothawai, this long-recognized neutral world to settle affairs with the greatest and most informed minds at the table. It is unclear what General Grievous intended with his invasion of the Both system, as this force would not have been able to penetrate the planetary shield, and the CIS had no wants of pushing the Spynet to work exclusively with the Republic. Likely, this was to capture some world or asset within this area of the galaxy, and not Bothawai itself. Since we do see a Separatist listening post nearby, perhaps they wanted to establish a similar outpost closer to the communications hub that was the Bothan system. When the Clone Wars came to an end with the establishment of the Galactic Empire, the Bothan spy net would continue to be a thorn in Palpatine's side. They worked with the new power, but as collectors of data, they knew more than anyone else that the horrifying genocidal accounts were true, that the Emperor was unlike any Supreme Chancellor before him, that each day that passed brought them closer to the inevitable declaration that Bothawai was too dangerous to be left independent. Aiding the nascent Rebel Alliance helped to tie up Imperial hands and force them to focus on this group instead of the Spynet. Like every conflict before, the Bothans would play both sides, giving up useful information to Imperial Moffs that did lead to devastating blows to the Rebel Alliance, earning the Emperor's trust and some more years of freedom, while many members of the Spynet were simultaneously helping the Rebellion, helping train new slicers and encrypting their communications to Rebel cells. By around the second decade of Imperial rule, the day finally came where a governor and a small garrison of stormtroopers were placed on Bothawai, but their council still did retain far more autonomy than most. When years later the first intel on a planet-killing superweapon were revealed, the Spynet upped their efforts to aid the Rebel Alliance. Knowing their strategy of neutrality was impossible, with an Imperial governor overseeing them, in a hyperspace traveling space station that could blow through any planetary shield now at play. Legends say that it was the Bothans who delivered the codes for the first Death Star to an Imperial Moff defector, who got them into the hands of the Rebel Alliance. With the destruction of this moon-sized battle station, the resulting counterattack on Yavin 4 would see the death of three Bothans that had become Rebel leaders. This was followed by the Emperor traveling to Bothawai with two royal guards, and personally killing hundreds of Bothans on their homeworld. Blood spilled on the streets of the capital of the world that for millennia had symbolized neutrality. All of Bothan society had turned on the Emperor after this, and the might of their galaxy-spanning spy net focused on any and all cracks in Imperial might. This included any attempts by the Empire to rebuild the Death Star. And 3 years later, they finally picked up on a computer core containing top-secret Imperial construction blueprints disguised in a freighter moving fertilizer. Luke Skywalker and Dash Rendar would lead a strike team on this freighter, ambushing them in the outskirts of the Both system, with 11 Y-Wings piloted by Bothans. six of whom would be killed. But the raid was a success, and the plans were decrypted by a Bothan team on one of their colony worlds, Kothless. With Imperial forces hot on their trail, they were nearly intercepted, but did ultimately get those plans to the Mon Calamari starcruiser named Independence, into the hands of Admiral Ackbar. The rebels scrambled to destroy this planet killer before it could be finished, since the plan showed that it was not yet defended. But Palpatine had played the Bothans, perhaps the only being in the galaxy that could outsmart them. He made this intel so difficult to find and highly encrypted that by the time that the Spynet revealed it, and after the best slicers in the galaxy collectively poured thousands of hours into getting these plans, they would never even consider that this was indeed
a trap.
Luckily, the Force was on their side, and over the moon of Endor, the Death Star would be destroyed along with the Empire. During the Civil War, they had created the Bothan Combat Response Element, a small fleet of stolen and reworked Imperial capital ships known as the Microfleet. Nothing of the Star Destroyer size, but this fleet was worked into the forces of the New Republic and used to protect Bothan space in the chaos of the collapsing Empire. Seeing how close the Empire had come at destroying them, the Bothans would start to build warships and maintain a military alongside their spy network. And like another great mind, Grand Admiral Thrawn, the Bothan Brass advised the New Republic to create large fleets of smaller ships instead of the behemoths that were the Star Destroyers and SSDs. By 1980, Bothawai would see waves of riots across the planet, secretly started by Imperial Remnant members. With the release of the Camus document, a supposedly declassified Imperial file, which implicated the Bothans in giving up intel that allowed the Empire to orbitally bombard the highly populated core world of Camus. Many NR allies turned on them, because of course there was truth to the claims that they were always playing both sides. But as the riots spread, some in the NR were keen enough to see that this chaos was covering up a secret operation to destroy the legendary planetary shield generators. Despite the efforts of Wedge Antilles and others, Imperial agents were able to pull off something the galaxy had long thought impossible, and actually shut down these planetary shields for some time, allowing for a planetary bombardment of this symbol of neutrality. But at the sight of Imperial ships, all forces knew they had been played, and the Bothans and their allies unified to destroy these remnant forces. Their military would grow even stronger after this, creating things like the Bothan Assault Cruiser, which would be in service during the Yuuzhan Vong War from 25 to 29 ABY. Conspiracies abound over why these alien invaders did not attempt to take Bothawai. It was of course heavily defended, but not nearly as much as Coruscant or some other worlds, and it was an incredibly important planet at a major hyperspace junction. But after this war was over, the Bothans were again a founding member of the new galaxy-spanning government, which rose from the ashes of the Vong War. By 40 ABY, the Second Galactic Civil War was led by Jacen Solo, and his ally, Sith Lady Lumaya, would convince the Bothans that the Alliance had turned against them, evoking the change from Republic to Empire, though at the end of the war, they would return to the GA and continue to have a prominent role in the leadership and unofficial power structures. Nearly 100 years later, in 137 ABY, Darth Krayt had learned from the mistakes of his Imperial predecessors, and instead of using brute strength to take Bothawai, he conducted a slow process of buying off prominent Bothan leaders, eventually using his influence to get them to allow for the establishment of an Imperial intelligence base on their world. Though the vast majority of Bothans were against this, and once revealed, both peaceful protest and violent riots spread throughout the cities targeting Bothans that had sold out. And though we do not know the ultimate result of this, we can assume that before long the Bothans were back to their fierce independence, with the Spynet keeping their invisible intelligence empire in place as one of the longest-running and most powerful organizations in galactic history. So that's it for their breakdown in history, but you definitely want to hear these cool facts and behind-the-scenes stuff. The world was originally known as just Bothan's Planet, or Bothan. They were first mentioned in Return of the Jedi, though expanded upon and depicted in the novel Heir to the Empire in 1991. Though descriptions differ across sources from hairy human to longer-snouted dog-like creatures and things in between, while this creature in 1985 Star Wars Droids is thought to be a Bothan. A lot of post-Imperial details come from the novel Spectre of the Past, while other stuff comes from Shadows of the Empire sourcebook, Guide to Alien Species, The Complete Encyclopedia, X-Wing novel series, and The Essential Guide to Warfare. If you made it this far, please hit that like button, leave a comment about the video, or make a request for future video topics, and subscribe if you want to see more. All that's the best way to help me out, as it promotes the video in the YouTube algorithm. You can check out the description for discount links, things like awesome Star Wars metal print art, and free audiobooks from Audible. You can also find our Patreon and PayPal, special shout out to our supporters over on Patreon, especially our $25 tier, Chris Garcia, Cass Costello, Matthew Beltrami, Bill Payne, and Brandon Robinson. But most important of all, remember, those incognito tabs didn't keep the Bothans out of your search history, so think twice before sending your invasion fleet, and the Force will be with you. Always.